Ladies and gentlemen, I am SidAlpha, and the concept of pre-orders within video games has been a method of driving sales that has long been unnecessary for most people. With the advent of digital distribution and direct from manufacturer copies, the concept of pre-order has shifted from its original inception with brick-and-mortar game stores. Now, the concept of pre-order is a method to drive sales before reviews or even significant gameplay footage is seen, and with the promise of some digital bonus, a great many people willingly purchase the game sight unseen and hope that it turns out to be good. As a result of gamers continually buying into pre-order culture and publisher hype, these same publishers have come to rely on pre-order sales to determine their day one metrics and first week sales metrics, information that they use to base long-term projections, and a great deal more that goes on within the business side of gaming. However, in the case of the upcoming release of Battlefield 5, or I should say Battlefield V, because it is in no way the fifth Battlefield, it would appear that pre-orders for the game are low, and this has caused rampant speculation and even heated arguments from the SJW and anti-SJW corners of that particular social ideologue boxing ring. With one side calling out anti-SJWs for hating on the game's trailer's heavy depiction of women on the front lines in the British theater, and the other extreme of the ideologue spectrum sitting back smugly with their Get Woke, Go Broke hashtag. There has also been speculation on other fronts here, so I thought it would be a good idea to sit down and go through everything. As always, we'll be starting off with what we know, and then once we get that out of the way, then I'll give you all my thoughts on the matter. So what exactly do we know? And I'm going to do my best to not phrase this in any way that will piss off one side of the argument or another. We'll save that for my opinions on the matter. And as always, links to any sources used, links to my social media, Patreon, and anything else are in the description down below. So let's start with the trailer. The trailer sparked a great deal of controversy surrounding the depiction of women on the front lines within the British theater of World War II. This sparked the debate on historical accuracy within the Battlefield game itself as well as the series as a whole. The trailer itself was extremely poorly received, which at the time I recorded this video, the trailer sat at 83,000 likes to 60,000 dislikes with a little over 2.3 million views. Also, as a result of backlash from the trailer, Patrick Soderlund decided to insult the fanbase by stating they were uneducated. Patrick Soderlund, along with EA developers for Battlefield V, have been telling people to not buy the game if they're unhappy with how women are depicted within it. But we also know that initially there was just as much backlash surrounding how the trailer felt more like a Call of Duty trailer than it did a Battlefield game, along with complaints that it looked cartoonish, it looked like Fortnite, and that it didn't look anything like World War II. But we also know that Battlefield V at least seems to be one of the least advertised Battlefield titles in recent memory, which could very well be a huge contributing factor to the lack of pre-order sales. Another common reason being cited is that Battlefield V is releasing in Broktober on the 11th. Right alongside the new Call of Duty Black Ops 4 on October 12th and Red Dead Redemption 2 on October 26th. Many are theorizing that this is giving the new Battlefield game the same treatment that we saw with Titanfall 2, a great game that was sandwiched in between the Call of Duty and Battlefield yearly iteratives of 2016. Analysts, journalists, and YouTube pundits alike have all speculated that Patrick Soderlund leaving EA just 2 months prior to the game's launch might have something to do with the weak pre-order numbers. However, it is important to remember that it was Patrick Soderlund that was the mastermind behind bringing loot boxes and microtransactions from the EA sports titles and shoehorn them into every single game released by EA. That, along with campaigns that Soderlund devised, caused EA's yearly income to skyrocket to the tune of billions of dollars per year. In a document filed in June of this year, it was shown that EA had awarded Patrick Soderlund $20 million in order to... Here, let me use their specific words here. I know I try to avoid that lately, but sometimes it's still a necessity. Now, EA stated, "The special equity award also was intended to support the longer-term retention of Mr. Soderlund, given that his creative successes, executive experience, and higher profile in the industry make him a highly desirable candidate for executive positions at other companies, including our competitors in the gaming industry, as well as broader technology companies pursuing interactive entertainment." And what that means is EA gave Patrick Soderlund a small fortune in a vain attempt to entice him to stay at EA, both to keep him earning huge amounts of money for them and also to keep him out of the hands of their competitors. Now, this paints a very clear picture that Soderlund was not at all leaving due to recent failures on the part of EA or that his leaving might be him being let go in any way. Quite the contrary, they actually are doing everything they can to keep him there, even though that has been unsuccessful. And to add to the tally of potential contributing factors, we have to include recent EA actions. We have the weak Star Wars Battlefront 1 EA release, where the game was rushed out the door without a single player campaign in order to meet the release window that coincided with the movie and then was all but deceased in less than 6 months. We have the Star Wars Battlefront 2 EA controversy surrounding its pay-to-win loot boxes and the fact that the game was mediocre at best. Then we have EA's closure of Visceral Games in order to pivot the design of the Star Wars game that was being designed by that studio in order to meet EA's goals of live services and recurring revenue streams, again a concept that was the brainchild of Patrick Soderlund. And then we have all of the smaller controversies that nip at EA's heels, such as the user accounts being completely erased for no reason and the like. And I'm going to slide into my opinion on all of this by saying that all of this paints a very clear picture that, unfortunately, many are merely focused on certain specific aspects while ignoring all others in order to paint a narrative that, frankly, doesn't even need to be painted. Stripping all social ideology bullshit aside, because I can't stand ideologues and I refuse to deal with that nonsense here, we are looking at a few specific aspects that do play a very relevant role in why Battlefield V pre-orders are not doing so hot. Firstly, we start off with the trailer nonsense. Now, regardless of any specific reason, the trailer was heavily disliked, with more people disliking it as opposed to liking it. This means that there is something very wrong here that will need to be addressed, but instead of addressing it, EA decided to insult those fans that weren't happy and call them uneducated. They then doubled down on that by stating, "Don't like it, don't buy it," which strikes me as a surprisingly unprofessional attitude from a normally very corporate EA that don't let anything out into the world until after it's been filtered through an army of public relations staff. We then have controversy after controversy after controversy with EA that all stem from their cynical applications of extreme greed within their video games to the point where there is no true creative element that survives the EA corporatization. Now, I don't doubt that there are hundreds and thousands of extremely talented game developers working for EA. I don't think anyone would be able to argue against that. The issue therein lies in EA itself, where they force every game that comes out of their doors to be extremely formulaic, taking no risks whatsoever, focusing instead on their yearly iteratives, their recurring revenue streams, live services production, and their microtransactions. Every video game from EA that I can think of over the past several years has been very pretty, with great graphics and admittedly some amazing musical scores, but ultimately samey and exceptionally bland, while at the same time being buggy and occasionally outright broken at launch. Everything about EA games have become uninspired filler that checks a series of boxes and moves on to the next. There is no feeling or impression of creativity or originality in any of their games anymore, and all that we're left with is a game that is designed to do nothing more than siphon money out of our wallets. Couple that with how they've been treating their customers of late and a general lack of advertisement, and it's no small wonder that pre-orders are significantly down. But ultimately, that's a good thing. Pre-orders are, by their very nature, anti-consumer. They force you into paying for a game before you even really know much about it, outside of what the hype train has delivered to you. They eliminate the chance to garner information from critics and streamers. They prevent a person from making an informed purchase, which is something that the publishers and developers very much desire. And I know we could banter back and forth about how in some circumstances it's okay to pre-order, but the only one that I would ever find to be acceptable would be if you plan on getting the game, but you aren't sure whether or not you'll have the money when the game launches. That I find to be perfectly understandable. But even when you plan on buying the game anyways, I would always advise you not to pre-order. Yes, you get some tiny bit of digital shiny thing when you do, but it does nothing except feed into the industry that is so married to the concept, and that concept will never be broken while people pre-order without a thought. Battlefield V pre-orders are down significantly. Great. Fantastic. I'm ecstatic that pre-orders are down. This in no way prevents me from buying the game at launch, nor will this fact preclude the possibility that it might be a good game. The fact that so many people are somehow worried about this, as some like Angry Joe are, I find to be completely baffling. We should be celebrating the lack of pre-orders and encouraging others to also not pre-order this game or any game. Is it a result of EA's behavior and past actions? Absolutely. Is it a result of social ideology? I'm also sure that's probably a contributing factor. Is Patrick Soderlund leaving because of it? No, I really doubt that. The fact is, there are a host of contributing factors here that have all congealed together into one amorphous blob, and while each faction on each particular topic will point and shout that this one singular thing is the reason, I hope that some people will be able to take a step back from their arguments and their echo chambers and take a broader view at the greater context of issues that are currently plaguing EA in general that are causing this to happen. But those are just my thoughts on this particular matter, and now I'd like to know your thoughts, so let me know what's turning around up inside that head of yours down in the comments. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, I am Sid Alpha, and I'll see you next time.